Hello and welcome on behalf of Rodon Schwarz to this 5G World presentation called First Results from Benchmarking of Commercial 5G Mobile Networks. I'm Arnd Sibila, Technology Marketing Manager at Rodon Schwarz for Mobile Network Testing. Before discussing the initial results of benchmarking, I would like to introduce the benchmarking methodology and explain whether this will change towards 5G or not. And I would like to introduce a new test methodology for testing more the 5G QoE part on the ultra-reliable low latency communication area, which is the interactivity. Our network performance score follows a methodology that has been approved and published by ETSI. You see in August 2019, you see the technical report number, and it's called Best Practices for Robust Network QoS Benchmark Testing and Scoring. The methodology has three levels. The most important level is number one, where we evaluate the QoE of all service classes. Service class normally has three components, three criteria. Service availability, do I have access to the service at all? Waiting time, how long do I have to wait for to see the first picture in a video stream, for example, and the quality of the media itself, what is the downlink throughput in a capacity test, for example. Level two is then weighting and aggregating the QoE of all service classes per region, which means per big cities, smaller towns, or rural areas. And the level three is then weight and aggregate all the regions to the countrywide score, the famous one figure where the CXOs are always looking at. It's important to say that the network performance score is technology agnostic, so the methodology will not change, but the results might change whether there is a 3G, 4G, or 5G network. So far the methodology, I would like to explain a little bit the new interactivity test now. In 5G, we see a lot of new applications coming up that request real-time capability of the network and interactivity of the network. And this interactivity is a combination of a bitrate, latency, and continuity. Our Qualibook Android software running on commercial smartphones sends a UDP stream of unique packets over the network, 4G or 5G network, to a certain server, and this server will immediately reflect the packets and send them downlink direction. The protocol used here on the server side is called two-way active measurement protocol. It's specified by IETF. We are not using ping here, that is often used for latency measurements, but with ping we cannot emulate the traffic pattern, and ping is also very limited in the accuracy, in particular if go for low latencies. And the TWAMP is definitely defined for service level agreement verifications of times, of latencies. And the result of this test is finally then the round-trip latency, the packet delay variation, and the packet error rate. And these three components are finally are condensing into the interactivity score. First component, latency, and you see here the interactivity score on the y-axis over the round-trip time in seconds. And here you see the nice S curve here for the interactivity score. And there are certain regions, perfect, tolerable, up to maybe or above 70% of interactivity score, and then down, further down, it's critical and even failed at the end. The second and third component is the delay variation and the packet loss. These are figures between 0 and 1, and they are basically scaling down the interactivity score curve coming from a latency linearly. Again, the interactivity score combines here the latency, packet delay variation, and the packet loss into a single test and a single score. We are using here the e-gaming traffic profile, so multiplayer cloud-based games, but we since the model is really scalable, so we can change the parameterization, we can use it for other things as well. So for example, on the upper end, you see here interactivity score, virtual reality, retail shopping, with relaxed requirements. Of course, it doesn't matter to see me in a new suit maybe 20, 30 milliseconds later. On the bottom here, you see the interactivity test for drone control or maybe for robot control in a smart factory. And you see the requirements are much tougher here. Yeah, so the curve is on the left side. So you see that this interactivity test can be parameterized, and so it can in the score can be applied as well to each interactive application that we can imagine. Okay, let's focus now on initial benchmarking results of 5G networks. So 5G world is normally London, so we used here data from the city of London. We collected the data in February 2020. We drove 1,600 kilometers in a drive test, and all results were used here in the category of city. So just one category here to make it easier to visualize. So the benchmarking campaign used our network performance score for sure, and this score is following the ETSI technical report that I showed you on the slides before. Measurement devices, we took here the Samsung Galaxy S10 5G as measurement devices for voice and data services, and we choose the 5G preferred mode for the tests. The data, you see the data sequence here, a sequence of tests here, and you see at the end, HTTP downlink and uplink 10 seconds, that is the capacity test, and you see the interactivity test at the end in all these two iterations. So the first results, capacity test. You see operator A uses two-thirds of all the samples using 5G, and there is also a portion of 4% with four carrier component carrier aggregation. You see operator D uses 20% 5G samples and roughly 40% if you sum it up here 5G and LTE carrier aggregation samples, and you see as well a significant portion of 8% just using 3G, so HSPA plus in this case. Operator B uses 3/4 of the samples use LTE single carrier. Yeah, and if you go for operator C, there is no 5G at all, because in February 2020, this operator did not launch 5G for commercial users. So you see here 80% just single carrier, 20% carrier aggregation. To understand as well the data throughput figures, it's important to understand which operator invests what bandwidth. And you see here, the darker the color, the more bandwidth is allocated to the carrier aggregation here. You see operator A uses the highest amount of bandwidth, invests the highest amount of bandwidth for data, followed by operator D here. It's also interesting to see the bandwidth allocation per technology. Here you see LTE single carrier, and operator A nearly uses the maximum possible, so 20 megahertz would be the maximum possible, and in average here 19.4, so nearly all single carrier allocations use 20 megahertz basically. If you go for the LTE carrier aggregation column here, you see that operator A invests around what 50 megahertz spectrum for carrier aggregation, or uses 50 megahertz for carrier aggregation, operator D only around about 34 megahertz. Here you see on the right side the LTE 5G and R column, and this is of course only the LTE bandwidth here, and you see operator A only half of that he uses normally for carrier aggregation, and operator D also around about 20 megahertz here used for the LTE anchor. And here we see a potential already, so if we combine basically the 5G carrier with more LTE carriers or with carriers of higher bandwidth, we could increase as well here the data rate coming via this LTE 5G combination. Let's talk about 5G NDC, why I'm showing here LTE cells, because it's very, very easy, because there's no 5G service without an LTE anchor. That is the short definition of 5G ENDC or non-standalone mode. And on the right side, you see now the number of LTE cells that are defined as anchor cells for 5G. And you see operator A uses much more cells here or as anchor cells for 5G. And also the portion, so 40% of the LTE cells of operator A are configured to be anchor cells for 5G. Operator D, for example, uses just 10% of all his available LTE cells as anchor cells for 5G. So coming to the first results here now, data has 60% of the weight, so maximum 600 points could be achieved. And you see operator A wins this data service here by around about 500 points, followed by operator D around about 460 points, and you see the results of the others. You see the breakdown in the capacity test. That is only the capacity test here, HTTP downlink and uplink throughput. And you see for each direction, you see three criteria here. First, the throughput in average. Then you see the throughput 10th percentile, which means how bad are the 10% worst samples. And the 90th percentile, how good are the best 10% of the samples. And you see immediately from this graph that the biggest potential for improvement is in the 10th percentile area, yeah, in downlink and in uplink direction. So you see that the figures are pretty bad here, and here an improvement would really bring a lot of more points for the score. And if you sum up the distance between difference between operator A and D for just the capacity test here, you see that only the capacity test nearly makes the difference between the number one and number two here in these overall scores. Let's go into a little bit more detail for the downlink capacity test. Above you see the average, and you see operator A 130 megabit per second, operator D 68 megabit per second. So there's nearly a factor of two between operator A and D. 90th percentile, that means the best 10% of the samples are above round about 300 megabits per second for operator A, and above 165 megabit per second for operator D. Let's come to the lowest, the worst 10% of the samples. They are below 10 megabit for operator A and below 4 megabit for operator D. So all these figures are very low. Yeah? So we saw before that here the big potential to improve the score is. It's also important to see the downlink throughput average per radio access technology. If you just go for LTE here, you see, okay, A and D pretty close together. You see the difference in 5G, where operator A leads with 178 versus 150 and 141. And you see here the mixed scenario 4G, 5G, and this is when you use two technologies for the same test. The capacity test has a duration of 10 seconds, and if you start the test in one technology and complete it in the other, it will appear basically here in this column, and consequently the data throughput figures are in the middle. So let's focus a little bit more on the 5G 5G data rates here. So we saw the numbers 178, 149, 141 for the three operators. And if we break it down now into the two components, the 5G component and the LTE component, the picture is different. For example, the 5G component, you see that operator D has the highest data rate on just the 5G part, on the 5G carrier. Yeah. But on the anchor cell, operator D uses the anchor cells much stronger. Yeah. So here is a factor of 2.5 between operator A and D, just on data rate coming via the LTE anchor cell. So that means the scheduling and the resource allocation is very, very important here for the overall performance, because at the end, operator A wins over operator D, although operator D has the highest data rate in the 5G carrier alone. To analyze the 5G samples a bit more, we often look at correlation plots, and here you see the example SINAR versus RSRP, and the data throughput is color-coded. And here you see the envelope curve. We are looking only at the 5G component here, and we see a similar behavior SINAR versus RSRP as we experience normally in LTE. It is okay for the early phase here in 5G deployment, but network optimization will happen or is happening already. So far for the data, now let's focus on the interactivity test. Again, remember, interactivity test combines latency, packet delay variation, and packet loss into a single score. And here you see operator D wins with 73%, and there's a big, big margin of 15 to 20% here between operator D and all the others. Interesting also to see the breakdown per technology. If you focus on 4G LTE, scores between A and D are pretty similar. Also for 5G, the scores are pretty similar. But the mixed scenario here, 4G and 5G, that is crucial here, because again, this is the tests that start in one technology and finalize in the other technology, this really brings down here the interactivity score, because normally a packet error happens here in the switch, and packet error rate has a strong negative impact here on the interactivity score, and it seems that operator A has a lot of cases here in these mixed scenarios. So let's sum up. The network performance score methodology has been approved and published by ETSI. The interactivity score combines testing round-trip latency, packet delay variation, and packet error rate in a single test and in a single score. And this forms the scalable QE model that we can use as well for other applications. The LTE anchor cell configuration is very important for the overall 5G performance, because we saw that many issues in early deployments of 5G are related to this LTE anchor configuration. We saw that scheduling the resource allocation on 5G and on the LTE anchor is still very important for the overall capacity test performance. And we saw from the interactivity test measurements that the network with the highest capacity is not always the best network for interactive application. So Rohde & Schwarz, the benchmark in benchmarking the quality and performance of mobile networks. If you want to know more, please visit our website. I put some links here. I'm happy to get your questions and now and in the following networking break. Thank you.